do you really need to hit rock bottom before you actually can change yourself? Or is there a way, you know, where it's not as painful probably before you really go into drastic change? Now, but on the other hand, I think most of us or a lot of us have experienced like probably a lot of painful experiences. And looking forward, it's always not only about what should I learn, what do I need to deepen in order to achieve my goals, but also what do I get to get rid of? What do I need to unlearn? And so now our next guest certainly has a lot to say around that and about the question, how to get over those things, how to unlearn habits that are holding you back. And as far as I know, she's a frequent traveler, but it's the first time in Austria. That means she needs an especially warm welcome. Please welcome on stage, Leslie.
The past few years have taught us a lot about human nature. It opened our eyes to our old fears, new passions, and even new innovations. But one thing is certain. We are all craving to be safe, seen, and heard. But what is holding us back? Today, it seems like we're going through life seeing a distorted picture of the world and making all our decisions based on this distorted information. Some of us are seeking safety with ourselves, being alone. Some of us seek safety with others, trying to please them or dominate them. And many of us are trying to persuade others to be like us. But whatever strategy we use, we all are seeking to feel safe. This sculpture, Love, was created by Ukrainian artist Alexander Milkov for the Burning Man Festival in 2015. And it depicts two adults, two wired frame adults, that just had a fight, distance, facing their backs towards each other. But what's interesting is the dichotomy of the young children inside that are reaching out for each other, trying to connect despite the outer bodies facing against each other. So I ask you, how does this structure speak to you? Is there a time in your childhood when you felt unsafe, fearful, or violated? And what was the strategy that you used to deal with, to survive that ongoing difficult situation? These survival patterns are what form the old habits that hold us back. With time, past traumas get so deeply conditioned in our bodies that it automatically kicks off when we're feeling distressed. And then it feels like that past distress is actually happening to us in the present moment, when in fact, it's not. So I'm gonna invite you now to think about that time in childhood when you felt unsafe. I'm gonna invite you all to just close your eyes and think about how you felt. That moment when you felt unsafe or fearful or violated, and give it one word, how you felt. And on the count of three, keeping your eyes closed, I'm gonna invite you to shout out that one word. Ready? One, two, 3. Oh, that wasn't very successful. I can't hear you. Okay, does anyone want to popcorn out their answer? Willing to share their one word, how they felt? Alone, yes. Scared. Anyone else? Shout that louder. Lost, yes. Okay. Well, I see you. And you. And I hear you. And you. And so I invite you to keep that one word top of mind. Because I believe that there is one thing that we all need to understand to unlearn the old habits that are holding us back, preventing us from stepping into our highest potential in whatever we do. It's that when we unlearn, when we understand and become aware of the unhealthy patterns of feeling and acting that helped us to survive when we were a child, to realize that that is stuck in our bodies and that those conditioned patterns, they're not our true self. When we can understand that and become aware of that, then we can rewire our brain. Then we can form new healthy pathways, new neural pathways, so that we can truly heal and that we can move forward more powerfully, positively, and purposefully. But here's our biggest challenge. If we do not consciously feel to heal the past traumas, then this shows up in adulthood. Because the mind forgets, but the body remembers. And so if we have unresolved childhood trauma, this shows up in adulthood as a need to control, toxic relationships, fear of abandonment, people-pleasing, struggle to set boundaries, and even addictions. So, I invite you to think about, as you go through today with me, is how can you start to shift out of that feeling? And we'll take you through a practice for that later. So I remember when I was 6 years old, I beat the reigning school spelling bee champion, and a boy spit in my face, saying I shouldn't have won because I was a brown-skinned new girl from the other side of the tracks, of Filipino immigrant descent. And the former champion was a white female. After that, I struggled with my self-worth and confidence. I got teased and bullied, and I had the limiting belief that I didn't belong, which essentially made me work really hard. I pushed my way through life, seeking external validation just to make myself feel safe. In Los Angeles, California, I graduated from the prestigious business school. I worked for the biggest entertainment studio in the world. I co-founded a successful real estate company. I found love online. I moved to London, got married, had kids, did all the things. And still, even in motherhood, I was pushing through the pain instead of letting life support me. And it wasn't until my childhood best friend, Bo, passed away at the tender age of 33 years old. And that changed everything for me. I didn't know what to do with those emotions that I was left with. I didn't know, no one dies at 33. And so as horrible as this was my personal epiphany. I realized, oh my gosh, that could have been me. I have kids. I think I'm invincible, but I'm not. And so that set in motion my own deep commitment to personal growth so that I can start to unlearn the old habits that were holding me back. So now I'm just going to invite you all to stand up from your chair. And I invite you just to start to shake it out. Just shake out your feet. Shake out, yeah, it's a long day today, isn't it? All right, so shake out your hands, your elbows. Yes, that's right. And I'm gonna invite you now to bring your feet hip distance apart. You're gonna trust me on this? Yes, all right. And invite you now to close your eyes. Start to bring your attention inward and start to shake. Just shake it out. There's no wrong or right way to do it. The only wrong way is if you don't shake. So just shake out your elbows, your fingers, your toes. Let's go. That's it. Come on, Graz. I know you got better than that. It's end of the day, day one. Let's go. And think about that moment when you felt unsafe. Or think about something today that made you feel distressed, that made you feel anxious, that made you feel, what am I doing here? And just shake it out. That's it. Keeping your eyes closed, bring your attention inward. You're all so shy here. Do I have to shake with you? All right. Okay. So let's shake. Shake it up. Shake it to the side. Really helps to keep your eyes closed. Stay in your own inner experience. Let's go. Yes, doing great. Just a few more moments. And the beat's coming, let's go. Shake. All right, keep your eyes closed. Keep your eyes closed. Rest one hand over your heart and one hand over your lower belly. And I just want you to notice. Notice how you feel in this moment. Notice that life force energy that's pulsating through you. That unique vibration that is only you. And how you feel right now, describe that in one word. And take a moment to compare how you feel right now and that word to describe how you felt unsafe in your childhood. Just notice. Beautiful. And when you're ready, coming back into the room, open your eyes and you can sit down. Thank you for playing with me today. All right, so let's go back to where we started. These slides are not working today, so let's go back. Okay, here we are. Okay, so let's go back to where we all started. So how does this all work? First, did you know that your subconscious mind is 1 million times more powerful than your conscious mind, and that it controls 95% of your life? Sigmund Freud, which I'm sure you all know, adopted the analogy of the iceberg in the sea, stating that our conscious mind is that tip of the iceberg. It's our thoughts, memories, feelings at any given moment. And underneath the sea, which most of us don't see, which is most of that surface area of the iceberg, is this massive memory bank that stores and remembers everything. Feelings, thoughts, memories, and those that are outside of our conscious awareness. Mostly unpleasant feelings of pain, anxiety, and conflict. The subconscious mind always stays alert and awake. It is the thing that helps us to make our body, our breathing, our organs, our cells growth, everything function. It thinks literally. It doesn't know the difference between reality and what's not. It is not logical. It's the feeling mind, and it's built on habituation. Second, how well do you know your nervous system? So our nervous system was designed to go through a regular cycle of charge and discharge. Excitement and soothing, tension and relaxation. Excitement is great, but not too much and for not too long. And so what happens is that as children, we don't know how to regulate our nervous system. It's up to our caregivers, our mom or our dad, to teach us. And this is one of the defining characteristics of childhood. And our ability to self-regulate our nervous system is one of the defining characteristics of adulthood. So our sympathetic nervous system, this is an activated response to perceive threats that we have in our environment, which is an evolutionary response from our ancestors so that they can protect themselves from life-threatening situations. Now, when too much energy hits our body or our nervous system, we get overwhelmed, right? And so you see there up on the slide, we're not facing like bears and tigers these days. We're facing social media, work, mortgage, which we still have this fight or flight nervous system response. And what happens is that if we, as children, are still experiencing feelings of overwhelm, if our caregivers have not reflected back to us how to safely soothe our feelings of overwhelm or anxiety, then we build these defense strategies so that we can feel safe. And these defense strategies are what become those habits. And these habits become survival patterns. And it is these survival patterns that disconnect us from our true self. And the parasympathetic nervous system is what works to counterbalance the effects of the sympathetic nervous system. It helps us to move from a state of emergency to a state of homeostasis. And so really what we're trying to do is become more and more aware of when are we in survival pattern? When are we trying to protect ourselves so that we can move more into presence? And so as adults, we can do all the things. We can do the spiritual practices of yoga, meditation. I did all of that. But until we actually heal the core traumas in our body, we will continue to do those old habits that are fueling those survival patterns. So now I'd like to really shake things up. I'd like to share with you something that is over 10 years in the making. Here are three keys to unlearn old habits that are holding you back. The first one is catalyze connection. So we've already talked about this, right? How can we start to reflect and realize how our childhood, how our experiences, whether good or bad, may have influenced how we show up as an adult, how we perceive the world? Because they say by the age of 7, definitely by the age of 12, our entire programming of how we see the world, life, love, relationships, money, career, has already been programmed. The second key to unlearn old habits that are holding you back is to choose consciously. And you already experienced this. How can you get out of your head and into your body? How can you move out of that conscious mind and into that subconscious mind, that feeling, and overturn that 95% and become more conscious? They say we make about 35,000 thoughts a day. So if you can start to do any somatic movement, shaking, dancing, whatever it is, just to move your body, whatever it is that the emotions, that pent-up energy that is stuck in each and every one of our bodies, allow yourself a healthy way to release that so that you can create that space for something new and better to come into your life. And last but not least, the third key to unlearn old habits that are holding you back is to create community. We are not meant to do this life alone. No more lone wolfing. It is about connection and collaboration over competition. And just by each and every one of you being here today, you are already taking a massive step towards that. So, if you master these three keys, catalyze connection, how your childhood has impacted and influenced your life as an adult. Choose consciously. Continue to do those practices to move out of your head into your body and make choices from that empowered space and create community. Be with people, things, and events that bring up your energy, people that speak the same language, and people that are like-souled, like-minded. If you do these three, your life will be so much more powerful, purposeful, and, of course, positive. So I'll leave you with this. Do you remember this image? What has changed for you? Think about the conversations you can be having with those around you that are now richer in meaning, deeper in connection, and more purposeful. Have the courage to create the change that you desire and you deserve. Don't be afraid to have a conversation with yourself, perhaps that inner child, so that you can renew your sense of wonder and curiosity. And do something that you're afraid to do. Ask for help. Pursue a new passion. Do the very thing that scares you, whatever it takes. And always remember, when in doubt, shake it out! Woo! Thank you.
Thanks so much for this exciting talk. I'm sure there must be a lot of questions. Volunteers are running around with microphones. Just raise your hands. I got one for you.
Yes.
I mean, I love it how you frame it and how you like give almost like a step-by-step introduction how to change things. Mm. And then if I change perspective and go on an organizational level, you know, I feel there's a lot of things you can do on a personal level, but somehow in an organizational environment, and a lot of people here mm-hmm. are confronted with some sort of organizational transformation, I mean, there would be a need to create a space for that. Mm-hmm. Do you have like some sort of playbook how to do that? What organizations could do to foster that?
Yes, thank you for asking. It starts with yourself. If you are a leader in your organization, how are you able to lead and hold space for others if you can't even hold space for yourself? So the more that you can do practices, the more that you can be aware of why it is that you make certain decisions, what is it that you need to do? How can you connect those dots? How can you start to connect not only your relationship to your personal relationships, but how do you connect that to your professional relationships? They say that the one way that we do one thing is the one way that we do everything. So even though people may come to me and say it's something professional, it always has some through line to personal. And how they do something personal always has a through line in how they do it professional. So I just really want to acknowledge each and every one of you for being here in this personal growth room, because this is really, really where the work begins. This is so important, and just really acknowledge you and congratulations for being here today.
Thank you. So, as far as I can see, there's a question in the back there. Yeah, please. And then there's one in the front.
One, two. Thank you for shaking things up, literally. As we were talking about childhood traumas and you mentioning having kids, is there any chance to avoid childhood traumas? I mean, you do your best to raise your kids, but there's no way around it, right?
This is a great question. Are you a mother?
No.
No, not yet. There's no way around it. We are all humans having a human experience. We experience life through polarity, fear versus love, good versus bad. That's how we experience life. I have children, yes. And always I'm like, oh my God, I could have done that differently. But that's life. That's life. And I've heard this from one of my mentors and coaches, is that we will always F up our children. No matter what we do, we will always F them up, because they need to learn. They need to grow and learn and evolve on their own. That is the human experience. So what we can do is just do our own work, again, hold the space for our children and just really encourage them so that they can make empowered choices on their own.
Thank you. There's another question here in the front.
Yeah. So first of all, thank you. I got goosebumps, I think, 90% of the time you were speaking. I have a question about trauma, especially past trauma, because you said to shake it out, to consciously make the effort of entering positive thoughts, if I got that correctly. But in order to heal the trauma, we cannot always replace the thoughts with better ones, right? We need to go to the root of the issue. How would you suggest one might do that?
I love this question. And we are not trying, just I want to just preface, we're not trying to spiritually bypass here. The work that I'm doing as a trauma-informed master coach and moving your body in these somatic-based practices is that for you to actually feel to heal. Did you kind of get that? We do not want to minimize the hurt, the anger, the rage, the grief, the sadness, whatever it is that we felt as a child. That's what we're acting out on. Someone said, shut up, be a good girl. Be a tough boy, don't do that. And so we are acting on these beliefs that we can't show emotions, we can't be vulnerable. So the idea is to also have a space, to have a container, whether like-minded people, have a coach, do practices, so that you can feel the breath of your emotions. Do not minimize that younger, what is your name? Rogue? George. Joe. Do not minimize little Joe. We want Joe to feel safe. And the healing is in the safety. Thank you.
Another question from, I can't see it exactly.
Hello.
Yeah, perfect. Thank you.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so I really love the shaking as well. I love to do it myself. It's really healing. My question is how to hold the space for kids, for example. Do you have a practical example?
You can do the shaking. You could absolutely do this with your kids. You can have them choose a song. Let them have choice and voice in what it is that you're doing. I'm not sure. How old are your kids?
1.5 and 4.5.
1.5 and 4.5. Okay, so they're little. Another great one is just to allow them to really use their voice, if they like to really use their voice. One of the things that I used to do with my kids when they were younger is this thing called karate chop, where you're literally as if you're gonna chop some wood, and then when you go down, you scream. I'm not gonna do it because I'm on a mic, but you go all the way down and you scream like you're chopping wood. The kids love this. The kids love this. And so this is just another way to not minimize if they're feeling overwhelmed, if they're feeling anxious, if they're feeling stressed. Because as kids, we don't know how to vocalize that, right? Or your 1.5 is maybe not speaking yet. So it's really for them to, how can they move their body, right? Or you can also do coloring. Maybe, how is it that you feel? Let's get some colors. As children, we don't have words to really put together with our feelings. So maybe they want to draw something, paint something, or color something. And just so they can have that safe space to express themselves is beautiful and safe in itself.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Welcome.
Is there one? We have time for one more question. Is there one? Can I see any hand in the room? Yeah, back there. Thanks for waving.
Okay, so my question is, how do we recognize when
you need to get pretty close with the mic so we can hear you.
Do you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. How do we recognize when we have those habits and when we, you know, we're not always conscious of what we do when we do it. And what's something that could remind us of being conscious and being there? You know what I mean?
So if I hear the question correctly, is what do we do to continue to be conscious and aware?
Yeah, because we tend to forget. And sometimes we're like on autopilot and we don't think about what we're doing.
Yes, great question. To continue to do these practices.
Yeah.
It's always about, it's a practice. It's like a meditation practice. It's like learning a language, learning an instrument. You have to keep flexing those muscles. You have to do those reps, basically. So the more and more that you do these somatic practices, the more you will feel, you'll know when you're coming out of your head into your body, you will intuitively know, all right, this is a hell yes, this is a hell no. The more and more you can just do those practices that resonate with you, you can start to lower that waterline of that iceberg and start to become more conscious.
Thanks so much, Leslie, for bringing all
pleasure.
This on this stage.
Thank you.
It was lovely to have you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Leslie.